When I was in the seminary, I spent a year living living in St. Patrick's in Smithtown. It's part of the program. You'd do 2 years of theology. You'd be in school full time, and then you got this break. In a sense, you got a break from the classroom, and you'd live in a parish for the year, and then you come back for 2 years. It was a great concept, a great experience. I had a really memorable year, and it's really just like an internship year. You live for a whole year, within parish. You just kind of get a real sense of parish life. You live in the rectory. The pastor when I was there was a wonderful guy. His name was at the time he was Father Paul Walsh. Eventually, he became an auxiliary bishop here in the diocese. He was just a great man, a great priest, and a great example for a guy who was discerning priesthood. Couldn't have had a better person to spend a year with. In fact, the whole rectory, all of the priests of the house were just really fine guys. So what I did for a lot of that year was I shadowed the pastor around. He would just, I'd kind of, as much as possible or as often as possible, I'd spend time with him. So I'd serve at mass, funerals, I'd serve when he had them. Communion calls, he'd say, I'm going to do a couple of calls, why don't you come with me? Anointings, probably that even more than the communion calls. Parish meetings, things like that. Just to, again, kind of get a sense of what it's like and what it would be like if I ultimately was ordained. Wakes, going to wakes. I would help him at the wake. I'd do a reading. At any rate, I was doing that for a couple of weeks, a couple of months. Was probably maybe Thanksgiving. The year started in September, and I remember he said to me one day, we were leaving a wake, we were coming back to the rectory, and he said, "Hey, you should do. Why don't you do the next wake service? You lead it." And I remember saying to him, "Yeah, sure," but thinking, no way. Like, I just, the thought of doing a wake service really kind of scared me. I guess part of it was just the public nature of it, public speaking. I wasn't used to that. Maybe it was also just the nature of the event, a funeral, a wake. So I just avoided it. I kind of maybe the following week he said, there's a wake Tuesday night, why don't you do it? And came up with some excuse. I had something else going on in the parish, and I remember kind of sort of making myself a little less available on days when there was a wake, and I was just dodging it. Anyway, one night we're at the table in the rectory having dinner, and he says to me just kind of casually, "What do you got tonight?" And I had nothing. So I said, "Yeah, I got kind of a quiet night." So he said, "Oh, good. Come do the wake with me." But he said, "With me." So I was like, "Okay, yeah, I'll go do the wake with him." So, had dinner, and then 20 minutes later, I get a call. We're going to do the wake, that evening. And he calls my room, and he says, "Brian, I need you to do the wake. Something came up. There was some emergency with a couple," I think he said, that he really needed to meet with this couple. So he said to me, "Could you do the wake?" And I was in a panic. I was like, okay. And as soon as I hung up, I bolted out of my room, ran down the hall to see if any of the other priests were around to kind of bail me out. And they weren't. Actually, one was, but he was unavailable. And so I had to do the wake. And I did it, I did the wake. I don't know how good a job I did, but I did it. And anyway, that was it. Came home that night. The next morning, I come down, and I'm Father Walsh is sitting, reading the paper. And I came in, and just kind of talking a bit. And then I said to him, how'd you make out with that emergency? And he looked at me, and he said, "What?" And I said, yeah, the thing. Oh, and he goes, oh. And then he looks across at the other priest who was there, and I can see they kind of smile at each other, and I know something's up. And then he looked at me and he just said, yeah, there was no emergency last night. You just needed to do the wake. It's kind of what it came down to. Sometimes you just have to do the wake. Sometimes you just have to confront the things that scare us. And I'm grateful. I'm grateful that he did that. He forced me to kind of face at least that fear. And as is so often the case, isn't it? You know, once you do confront it, whatever it is, you know, most of the time, you're realizing this wasn't. Man, I shouldn't have avoided this the way I did. And in the process, you realize, man, I am capable. And this can be done. And I should be doing it. There was a ESPN does this. They do this survey. I think they do it every couple of years, where they poll or they survey listeners. Well, actually, it's two groups of people. It's the fans, people who, you know, watch ESPN, and then sports writers, sports journalists. And the survey, the poll is, what do you think is the best sports movie ever? Of all the movies about sports, which one is the most? And they compile, they get the, you know, the experts, and they got the fans, and they do all this. They compute it somehow, and they come up with this list. And there's one movie more than any of them that has consistently been number one. I don't think every year, but most times they've done it, it's number one, and it's always top three. And it's actually one of my favorite movies. It's called Hoosiers, and Gene Hackman is in it. He plays this high school basketball coach. It's a basketball movie. Early 1950s, Indiana, in the middle of nowhere, this tiny little school, small town, where basketball is sort of God. It's just, they live for it. And you know what, like I'd say great sports movies, the sports part is almost incidental. That's sort of the context, but the movie is, anyway, this movie's just got so much. I mean, it's about redemption, and it's about, you know, fathers and sons. It's about under David and Goliath. It's about integrity. There's so many scenes that are just worth noting. Anyway, the coach is he's running this team, and one of the fathers of one of the players is this guy. His nickname is Shooter. And he's really kind of the town fool. He's certainly the town drunk. He's an alcoholic who's just has nothing really to do with his family anymore. But he's kind of a basketball encyclopedia. He knows everything about Indiana basketball. So he's always in the periphery. His son is ashamed of him, wants nothing to do with him. He's just consistently disappointed him. And the coach he sees all this. He realizes the dynamic there between the father and the son, and sort of the sad life that this father is living. And he goes to his house one day, and the house is a bit of a disaster. It's in the woods, the shack, essentially. And he meets with him, and he says to him, I'd like to offer you something. He said, I'd like you to help me coach this team. And he's honored. I mean, nobody's asked this guy to do anything in forever, essentially. And he's amazed by that. So he says, I'd love to. So they make this agreement. And then the coach, Gene Hackman, says to him, but there's one thing. You need to stop drinking. And you need to clean up your act. You need to show up in a presentable way. And you got to stop drinking, because you're embarrassing your son. And ultimately he does. Not right away, but eventually he shows up sober and clean, and he starts to help coach this team, ultimately to a state championship. But there's a great scene. He's been assistant coaching now for a while, And one day, the head coach deliberately gets thrown out of the game. He starts arguing with the ref, and he ejects him. And it's intentional. He's the only one who knows it, though. The assistant coach, Dennis Hopper, plays the assistant coach. He's has no idea, doesn't realize what's going on. Gene Hackman turns to him, hands him the clipboard, and he says, "You got to take over. You can do this." And he hands it to him, and he just kind of looks him in the eye, and then he walks away. And then the look in Dennis Hopper's eye is like he's panicked, because he just doesn't feel like he's capable of doing this. Well, he does. He does. And they win this game in dramatic fashion, and just confidence is restored in this guy, and redemption. His son looks at him, and at the end of that game says, "Dad, you did good." It's just a great moment. It's a great scene. And I think in some ways, is that really what we remember today and what we celebrate today when we talk about the Ascension? It's like, you can do this. You can do the wake. You can coach the game. Like, you can do this. I know you're scared. I know you got doubts. But you can do it. I mean, it says it in the gospel. It says they were doubting. They were scared. The apostles. And ultimately, I mean, I think this day is more about us than it really is about Jesus. I mean, what's more obvious than Jesus goes to heaven? Like, on a certain level, do we need a special day to acknowledge the most obvious fact of faith maybe ever? Yes, Jesus goes to heaven. Well, tell me something we wouldn't presume. Tell me something we don't already know. I think it's less about that and the obviousness of that, and it's about, so what's next? What happens when Jesus goes? What do we do with that? "Jesus, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" they say. He's like, "No, essentially, you will. You will receive the power to restore it. You be the witnesses. You can do this. You are capable of this." So what's the clipboard look like? In the movie, the coach hands him the clipboard, like, "Here, this is what you got to do." But you really know it. You just got to believe that you know it. And for him in that moment, yeah, that's what it was. It was this clipboard. Game plan. Plays. What's your clipboard? What maybe is God asking of each of us? Something that he needs us to do, and we've been dodging it. We're just afraid. We lack the confidence. So we come up with excuses. We become amazing at avoidance. There's a quote, I think it was attributed to Eleanor Roosevelt. Apparently she said, "Every day you should do something that scares you." Every day you should do something that scares you. That's interesting. I mean, I don't know about every day. That might be a little intense and maybe a little dangerous. But I do think there's something to that. Like, face your fears. Because we transcend them. We transcend the moment. Because he is with us. Because that's what he said. That was his final words of this gospel. "I'll be with you." So even though you feel like you're alone, and in some respects you are alone, you're really not. If you know that I'm here. Well, for me, 30 years ago in Smithtown, it was the wake. What's your wake?